Welcome. Welcome to the fourth annual Lester Kissel Lecture. I'm Arthur Applebaum, Director of Undergraduate Fellowships at the Edmund J. Safra Center for Ethics, and I have the most pleasant duty of introducing our speaker, Professor Stephen Macedo. But first, a few words about our dear Lester. Lester died in the year 2000 at the age of 98. He had been the managing partner of Seward and Kissel, a major Wall Street law firm specializing in financial law, representing banks, investment funds, hedge funds, and the like. In his early 60s, he started reading Hindu ethics and asked himself, is this all there is to life? This being a lawyer for large banks. And he began going to India, even had a guru who taught him that reincarnation is real and that with sufficient study and work, he might come back as a worthy soul. We know what he will return as, don't we? Kissel's longstanding interest in values in public and professional life led to his commitment to the ethics initiative at Harvard rather early on, beginning with conversations and correspondence with President Derek Bach, and later with President Neil Rudenstein and our founding director, Dennis Thompson. In the fullness of time, he did live until 98, Lester bequeathed to the Ethics Center a magnificent gift. Lester would visit us in between his treks to India, and each time he would remind us, rather like an oracle, to attend not only to ethics, but to values. And he'd trot off again to India. And he never explained this distinction between ethics and values, but I think I know what he meant, and that's what makes Steve Macedo an especially fitting choice to be our Kissel lecturer this year. No, Steve, it's not that you've been the longtime director of our sister institution, Princeton's University Center for Human Values. As a Hindu, I don't think Lester had any particular species in mind when he referred to values. And it's not because you have been so valuable to me. I first met Steve when we were both young pups on the Harvard faculty. He reminded me just now that he began his teaching career either in this room or the room right downstairs more years ago than either of us care to remember. Unlike Steve, I had misspent my youth and was frantically trying to teach myself some political philosophy. I remember having long, formative, and dare I say, remedial talks with him sitting on a bench overlooking the Charles River. But that's not why you're fitting for this. It's rather that you have shown us throughout your career, from your early work right up until the lecture that we will hear this evening, that liberal political philosophy, properly understood, is not only consistent with, but cannot be done without, an account of values and virtues. Steve has an answer to the old quip that a liberal is someone who can't take his own side in an argument. Not so. In an early important book, Liberal Virtues, Steve has this to say. Communitarians charge that liberal regimes pay a high price for their central concern with diversity, individuality, impersonal law, and rights. What is lost, allegedly, is the possibility of a moral community, a common devotion to shared values. Liberal theory can provide an attractive vision of distinctively liberal community and liberal virtues while remaining true to its core political convictions. Liberals can reclaim a language which supposedly lies beyond the bounds of liberal politics, the language of virtue, citizenship, community, and human flourishing. In the case of God versus John Rawls, a paper that is every bit as good as its title, and later in a book, Diversity and Distrust, Steve articulates a vision of civic education in a multicultural democracy that shows how commitment to equal liberty can be taught to and cultivated in children from diverse and conflicting moral and religious backgrounds while satisfying the demands of Rawlsian public reason. And I've been assigning chapters from that book to my students for quite a number of years now. This vision of political liberalism is carried forward in his latest and most timely book, Just Married. Marriage, according to Steve, is a great good that can be recognized and protected as such by law without the state taking sides between competing comprehensive moral or religious conceptions of what the good of marriage is. We'll hear a version of this argument this evening. Please join me in welcoming Stephen Macedo, the Laurance Rockefeller Professor at Princeton University, whose lecture this evening is entitled No Slippery Slopes, same-sex couples, monogamy, and the future of marriage.
That's very kind. Thank you. That's very, very kind, way too kind, but I'll take it. Yes, I began my teaching career 30 years ago in this building downstairs. I'm almost as nervous tonight as I was then. I began with the assignment of filling in for Harvey Mansfield, I think, in the intro Gov 10 course, which involved five lectures on Thucydides to get started off, who I had not read since I was a freshman in college. Anyway, I'm going to leave it at that. All right. Let's hope this goes better. thank you all for coming. I deeply appreciate it, and I appreciate this opportunity. On June 26th, this past year, the Supreme Court made history by holding that the Constitution's guarantees of liberty and equality require that the states must extend the right to marry to persons of the same sex. The speed with which same-sex marriage came to the United States seems astonishing. 30 years ago, a majority of the justices voted to uphold laws that criminalize sex between consenting adults in the privacy of their own home. And it was only in 2003 that that decision, Bowers versus Hardwick, was overturned. And that same year, the Supreme Judicial Court of Massachusetts made this state the first to recognize the right of same-sex couples to marry. A dozen years later, and here we are. The revolution is over. Or is it? Conservatives such as Antonin Scalia and others have warned for decades that the most basic rights for gay and lesbian Americans would put us on a slippery slope to legalize polygamy along with, and I quote, adult incest, prostitution, masturbation, adultery, bestiality, and obscenity. Chief Justice Roberts, in his dissenting opinion in Obergefell, the same-sex marriage case from this past year, reiterated that, and I quote, a leap from opposite-sex marriage to same-sex marriage is much greater than one from two-person union to plural unions, which have deep roots in cultures around the world. My colleague Robert George and very many conservative scholars and activists continue to warn that in the wake of Obergefell, polyamory, which is the name given to group marriage or egalitarian plural marriage, and even adult incest are now moral certainties. The logic of liberalism, as represented by Justice Kennedy's opinion in Obergefell, compels the further extension of basic rights to consensual adult groupings of three or more, otherwise known as thruples or moresomes, and also, as I said, to adult siblings or even parents and their adult children who wish to wed. Some will write off this kind of talk as right-wing fear-mongering, but in fact, many scholars and activists on the left have embraced much of the slope, and some have embraced all of it. These progressives argue that same-sex marriage is an unstable, an unprincipled stopping point on the path to more radical reform. Sonu Bedi at Dartmouth argues that liberal neutrality invalidates both prohibitions on same-sex marriage and marriage itself. Preserving marriage and extending it to gays, he says, takes sides in very personal decisions about what constitutes a good life. And he says that that is no more than natural law, but with a gay spin. The liberal state should get out of the marriage business, leveling down to universal status of civil unions, neutral as to the gender and purposes of the domestic partnership, according to Andrew March. Elizabeth Brake argues that monogamous civil marriage unfairly favors amorous dyads and denies recognition to many other caring relationships, including polyamorous unions. And some go to, as far as I said, to argue that categorical prohibitions on adult incest must be lifted, at least where there's no possibility of generating genetically damaged offspring. Sonu Bedi provocatively offers the example of two gay brothers who wish to settle down. Frederick de Boer put it very simply in a widely cited posting on Politico this past summer, and I quote, consent is the measure of all things in matters of sexual and romantic practice. Now, these remarks build on and extend the arguments of the book that Arthur mentioned, and I'm responding as well to some things that have been said in the wake of Obergefell this past summer. My argument is that same-sex marriage, civil marriage as a status relation in law, and monogamy all make sense here and now, given what we know about plural relationships. In fact, I go further and argue that the law of marriage facilitates the availability of a central aspect of the human good, and that monogamy plays an important role in supporting not only equal liberty, but also the fair opportunity to pursue the good of married life, making monogamous marriage itself an important aspect of our constitutional order. Now, I don't think that the critics are all wrong. In particular, it's a condition of just marriage, and justice generally, that we provide far more adequate support than we do to all children and all parents, regardless of marital status. I don't want the support of marriage to be an excuse for not making good on the requirements of justice with regard to social welfare. And I want to affirm that clearly while also spending most of my time discussing marriage, which is my particular subject, and this question of the slippery slope. So I'm going to say just a word about the conservative arguments against same-sex marriage, in part because these conservative arguments, it seems to me, have so little to do with what marriage amounts to now in this country. Post-Obergefell, the broadened understanding of marriage that's so quickly gaining higher levels of support in this country. And in part because I think it'd be important to recruit thoughtful conservatives in the task of thinking about the future of marriage. And I think in some ways that the preoccupation of some conservatives with same-sex marriage has given a bad name to conservative concerns about marriage and family in general, and I think that's too bad. So just a few words about the conservative arguments, which I spend a couple of chapters on in the book. The only serious, I think, philosophical argument is the new natural law argument, advanced mainly by conservative Catholic scholars such as my colleague Robert George, as well as John Finnis and others. That argument holds that the natural teleology of the body supports a conception of marriage as consummated by coitus or intercourse, the sexual act ordered to procreation. In a book called What is Marriage?, Sharif Georgis, Ryan Anderson, and Robert George say that marriage is necessarily formed by, and I quote, only a man and a woman, because marriage is a union whose norms and obligations are decisively shaped by its essential dynamism towards children. And crucially, that dynamism comes not from the actual or expected presence of children, which some same-sex partners and even cohabiting brothers could have, and some opposite-sex couples lack, but from the way that marriage is sealed or consummated in coitus, which is organic bodily union. In other words, according to these philosophers, it's the baby making sex, not the babies, that makes sense of marital norms of two-ness or monogamy, permanence, and exclusivity. This book was cited by Justice Alito in his dissent in the U.S. versus Windsor, though he didn't explain what he found persuasive about it. Georgis, Anderson, and George advanced the startling claim, and I quote, that marriage is possible between only two because no act can organically unite three or more, or thus seal a comprehensive union of three or more lives. In other words, marriage is possible only between two because only two people can have intercourse at the same time. No defender of polygamy would be moved by that observation, which seems irrelevant. We need to deal with the issue of plural marriage, a serious issue, on its own merits. Polygamy obviously long predates same-sex marriage, and it does have a long history, and it's still widely practiced. So we can and should assess it on its own terms as a distinctive social form, I will do so in a few minutes. In fact, of course, the two-ness of coitus or intercourse tells us very little about why most people aspire to permanence in marriage, or why monogamy and fidelity are features of the institution of marriage as we know it, or indeed why these features of marriage are good. Similarly, on average, babies benefit from marital stability and indeed from two-parent marriages, on average. But the new natural law argument is, as I said, that it's not the babies but the baby-making sex that calls for permanence, fidelity, and monogamy. The practical reason being, that they want to include infertile heterosexual couples in marriage but exclude same-sex couples. Okay, I'm not going to say any more about this argument or about coitus, unless you insist. We can talk about it later in the question and answer session. The most often heard argument in the federal and state courts leading up to Obergefell was not the natural law argument, but the channeling argument. It is that the law has a special interest in channeling heterosexual couples into marriage on account of the worry that heterosexual sex can lead to accidental procreation, which cannot result from gay sex. In fact, BLAG, the legal arm of the House of Representatives, in this case representing the views of the House Republicans, put it this way in its brief in, I think it was Windsor. Thank you, Jim. It's no exaggeration to say that the institution of marriage was a direct response to the unique tendency of opposite sex relationships to produce unplanned and unintended offspring. And that provides the states with a reason to offer marriage to heterosexuals, but not homosexuals. The argument was subjected to withering criticism by Richard Posner. And I quote, heterosexuals get drunk and have sex, leading to unwanted pregnancies, and their reward is to be allowed to marry. Homosexuals cannot do that, so they cannot marry. Go figure. Posner pointed, this is from his opinion, federal court opinion in Baskin versus Bogan. Yep. Posner pointed to another anomaly. While some of the states that prohibited same-sex marriage generally prohibited marriage among close relatives, these states, citing the channeling argument for excluding gays from marriage, they generally prohibited as well the marriage of close relatives, including first cousins. Some of those states made an exception for heterosexual couples who are 65 or older because they cannot procreate. So those states that relied on the channeling argument carved out a special permission for heterosexual couples to marry in cases where they couldn't procreate, while excluding same-sex couples in general from marriage because they can't procreate. The inconsistency is glaring. As Posner put it, and I quote, elderly first cousins are permitted to marry because they can't produce children. Homosexuals are forbidden to marry because they can't produce children, defying the claim that the law is animated by a general concern with channeling procreative sex for the sake of children. And of course, what makes it worse is that many of those same-sex couples were actually raising children. A third argument advanced by conservative same-sex marriage opponents held that being raised by one's natural mother and father is the best marital arrangement for children. David Velleman, a philosopher at NYU, offered a version of this argument, though not as an argument against same-sex marriage, I think, in his article, Family History. There are several obvious problems with a claim about ideal family forms when offered as an argument against same-sex marriage. One is that access to heterosexual marriage has never been restricted to its ideal variants, and that's because it's such an important opportunity for people to be able to enter into a marriage with one other person. The right to marry one other person has been held to be fundamental in cases involving not only interracial couples, of course, but convicted felons, and fathers who haven't paid child support from previous marriages. Unlimited no-fault divorce and remarriage is easily available to heterosexuals. Mickey Rooney, who was married 9 times, famously said, always marry early in the morning. That way, if it doesn't work out, you won't have wasted a whole day. Denying gays marriage rights doesn't stop them from adopting or conceiving children, and the good of those hundreds of thousands of children being raised by gay couples is certainly set back by denying their parents the right to marry. Moreover, same-sex couples have one inherent advantage when it comes to childbearing. The fact that they can only have children after careful and deliberate planning means that children born to same-sex couples can be sure that their parents really want them. Sort of the obverse of the channeling argument when you think about it. So conservative arguments have been aired in academic journals and courtrooms and seminars, talk radio shows and elsewhere for decades. And let me add, you know, the point that I survey this because I have genuine sympathy with some conservative concerns about marriage and family life, as will become obvious. But the palpable weakness of these arguments against same-sex marriages encourages people to discount the whole conservative point of view on these matters. And that's a shame, because there's a kind of small C conservatism that makes a lot of sense, I think, when it comes to the reform of very complicated legal institutions like marriage. Now, the final argument relied on by conservatives, of course, is something like the slippery slope argument. And it continues to be relied upon, as I said, as well as embraced by many on the left, many ethicists, political theorists, law professors, and people in the blogosphere and elsewhere who have said that fairness, respect for individual autonomy, and the equal dignity that was at the heart of the Obergefell decision all require more radical reform. And I should emphasize at the outset here, there are some attempts at humor in these remarks, and I'm going to sort of state my argument as clearly, you know, as I can, in a brief amount of space. But these are all serious arguments. I acknowledge that the truth about none of these matters is crystal clear. We've learned a lot about sexual orientation, sex, And I think marriage over the last three decades, four decades, while having these debates about same-sex rights, there's no, the natural law argument that I talked about has been significantly developed in response to the arguments about same-sex rights and same-sex marriage. A new basic good was announced by the new natural lawyers, the good of marriage, specifically designed for this argument. And so I think we're all learning about these things, and I don't want any of what I say to suggest that I don't think all of these arguments are extremely important and difficult. All right, so as I said before, there are a variety of critics of marriage coming from the more progressive end of the spectrum, and I'm going to focus on them in the remaining time. There are a variety of proposals, a variety of concerns that are articulated by progressive marriage critics. Some focus on the issue of numbers and seek to open marriage to more than two spouses. Some of these advocates of more radical reform are willing to accept polygamy in its traditional form, one husband with multiple wives, or polygyny. But others argue that we have no reason to expect that polygamy of the future will resemble polygamy of the past, and so many, including some of those I've mentioned, and many others, expect plural marriage of the future to be the more egalitarian form, as I mentioned, of polyamory, or group marriage, loving networks of various combinations of men and women. And yet other critics of marriage quite properly follow a long line of feminist thinkers and say that marriage itself is a poor vehicle for recognizing and supporting the basic need that we all have for caring relationships. The need for care in its many forms is the most basic and inclusive good at stake here. And marriage is an under-inclusive and unfair vehicle for recognizing and supporting the good of care. This seems to me to be quite a valid concern that needs to be addressed somehow. There are various proposals for addressing this good of care, of course. Elizabeth Brake would retain the word marriage in law, but radically reconstitute it on a much broader basis to include adult caring and caregiving relationships of all sorts, of any number, any combination of genders, without regard to reciprocity, romantic love, or sex. She argues that individuals should be able to pull apart various legal aspects and incidents of marriage and share them with a variety of people and call them all marriages, so that someone might share a home with an elderly relative, raise a child with a close friend, have sex with a high school sweetheart, and give surrogate decision-making powers, in the event of incapacitation, to a trusted advisor, and call them all marriages, entering into multiple marriages. This is the most creative proposal, and it's cited frequently by conservative scholars. Others, Tamara Metz, who's a PhD student from here in the Gov department, now teaching at Reed College, I think, would redesignate the institution, call it intimate caregiving units, and similarly make it available to adults in all caring and caregiving relationships. And other critics focus on what they see as the problematic aspect of the special status of marriage in our law. Marriage is a status relationship that's defined in advance by law before we enter into it. And it does have a special status, a special meaning, special resonance in our culture. And they see that as problematic, as being problematically honorific. Some of those folks who focus on the status of marriage also emphasize the advantages of contractualization and personalization of marriage. They emphasize that the status aspect of marriage encourages people not to think about the specific terms they want to be represented in their own marriages. Cass Sunstein and Richard Thaler, in their book Nudge, have a chapter called Privatization of Marriage, where they urge that we adopt a more contractual model to encourage this personalization, privatization, and they would designate that civil status as civil union or domestic partnership and leave to churches and private associations the task of defining marriages for themselves. This book is about 7 or 8 years old now. It would dial down the cultural conflicts around marriage, they think, and be a more libertarian proposal that would allow for a diversity of understandings of marriage, this special status in our culture, reflecting particular religious meanings, cultural meanings, and so on. Now, and I think, indeed, many of these proposals, I'm not going to talk about all of them, but I'll talk about a few aspects of them. One thing that many of them share is the judgment that the normative resonance and cultural power of marriage illegitimately constrains freedom and diversity. Marriage entwines law, politics, centuries of cultural understanding, religious meanings, and social norms, so as to impart a deep and distinctive shape to people's self-understandings. I mean, monogamous marriage imparts a deep and distinctive shape to our aspirations for our lives as a whole. And this constrains our freedom in various ways, the fact that we enter into a culture that's so deeply defined by marriage, and that can't be right in a liberal democracy. And yet it seems to me that the case for monogamous marriage turns partly on precisely its capacity to shape our deepest aspirations, our ethical judgments, and even our religious convictions in order to secure equal liberty and fair opportunity for all. It is, moreover, legitimate for the liberal state to facilitate people's pursuit of good lives so long as it does so fairly. And it behooves the liberal state to do so in such a way that helps to secure a stable regime of equal liberty. And it's on this basis, I think, that liberals, broadly speaking, should support the preservation of monogamous marriage. So I'll begin by saying a few words about these arguments that focus on the special status of marriage in our law and culture, and then say something even more briefly about the various legal incidents of marriage that are packaged together under the rubric of marriage in state and federal law. And after that, I'll turn to the issue of monogamy. So to anticipate my conclusions, the status aspect of marriage, its meaning and resonance in our culture, serves, it seems to me, specific and defensible functions. And then the various legal incidents of marriage, the rights and obligations of married couples, very many particular rights and obligations, those, it seems to me, are all subject to ongoing negotiation. And some of them should be disaggregated from marriage and redistributed to people in non-marital caring relationships. But we should do that while preserving marriage as a distinctive status, I think. And then finally, again, just anticipating my argument, everything we know about polygamy or plural marriage as experienced in human history and as experienced across the world currently suggests that we are well off for having left it behind and that monogamy supports basic constitutional values of equality, liberty, and fair opportunity. All right, so to start then with the symbolic dimension of the word marriage, and then the various legal incidents. One thing to note at the outset is this issue came up a number of times, the question of the public meaning of the status of marriage, the word in our culture, because same-sex couples had available to them in Massachusetts, in Vermont, in California, civil unions or domestic partnerships with all the same terms as marriage, at least in state law. And judges said more than once, including in California, New Jersey, and elsewhere, we're having all this litigation about the word marriage. These couples have available to them civil unions or whatever with the same terms. And over couples, or the litigants, the attorneys would say, yes, marriage itself has a distinctive meaning, and that's an important part of what's at stake. So that's what I want to explore here. I defend the common sense understanding of marriage as it's come to exist in America over the last half century or so. I take its core to be the public declaration of two people who commit in public to loving and caring for one another over a lifetime and to building a life together in common. This is the core of the marriage vows, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and health, till death do us part. Notwithstanding a divorce rate that hovers at a bit over 40%, marriage is still a presumptively permanent commitment of two people to build a common life, to stick together through all of life's trials, and to work at making the commitment work. Now, one obvious response will be, what about love? I think Valentine's Day is coming up. Surely marriage at its core is an emotional bond based on love. I don't want to discount that. Of course that's important. But couples nowadays generally fall in love, have sexual relations, and cohabit before marrying. So the emotional bond is already there without marriage. But so it seems to me that what marriage distinctively brings is publicly declared commitment to building a life in common. No other status has the same social meaning. Domestic partnerships, civil unions, and other options have comparatively unclear meanings and implications. And this has been recognized quite clearly by the litigants themselves in the marriage cases. For Kristen Perry, for example, one of the lead plaintiffs in California's Proposition 8 litigation, marriage, she said, provided access to a language to describe her relationship with her partner. She said, and this is before Obergefell, of course, I'm a 45-year-old woman. I've been in love with a woman for 10 years, and I don't have a word to tell anyone about that. Marriage would be a way to tell our friends, our family, our society, our community, our parents, and each other that this is a lifetime commitment. We're not girlfriends, we're not partners, we're married. So marriage itself is a very public as well as a personal commitment. Once people know you're married, all sorts of presumptions follow. A train of generally understood legal entitlements follow as well. Hospital visitation rights, the right to information from doctors, decision-making authority in the event of incapacitation, and the right to jointly control property, social invitations will naturally flow to both spouses, and so on. If marriage has a reasonably well understood public meaning, and of course I just scratched the surface, what's added by the law of marriage? Here I draw on a very good article by Rafe Wedgwood. The existence of the legal form of marriage facilitates the fulfillment of people's serious desire to get married and be married, not just as a matter of private commitment or private concern, but as a matter of common knowledge. The law of marriage helps make the relationship of marriage socially legible, not just to members of my church, my subgroup, but across the whole society. And this social legibility has been recognized by people on both sides of the political spectrum as something that's of central importance. John Finnis, leading natural lawyer, has emphasized, and I quote, the fundamental simplicity and intelligibility of marriage as a legal framework. Andrew Sullivan, decades ago, defended the benefits of, and I quote, a clear common symbol of commitment. So publicly committing to marriage furnishes a way for couples to signal their commitment to one another and to make it known to others. And the commitments of marriage once entered into become social expectations and basis for normative judgment. The opportunity to undertake such a commitment, to assume certain constraints and bear certain obligations while also enjoying a variety of benefits, including greater mutual assurance that comes with the assumption of marital bonds, is a valuable option. And therefore freedom enabling so long as the decision to marry is freely undertaken. And that of course furnishes a ground for making sure that not too many basic social welfare benefits turn on marital status, such as health benefits and various other things, because we want it to be freely undertaken. Now some say the idea of marital commitment is becoming increasingly passe given a divorce rate that rose as high as 50% since declined, and the percentage of adults in America that are married is less than it once was. And it's true that more Americans are choosing cohabitation over marriage and so on. Yet among Americans 25 years old or older, 80% are either or have been married, and more than half of the never married would like to be. The divorce rate has declined since its peak in the early 80s, and marriage is especially healthy among the college educated who are well situated economically with respect to the ability to make that decision. This has been ably explored in Robert Putnam's book, Our Kids. And marital norms also remain powerful. 82% of Americans said in 2004 that adultery is always wrong, and that was up from 70% in 1973. So the marriage and the marriage option is not only valued but valuable. The same benefits that tend to flow to heterosexual couples, especially men, in terms of greater health, greater happiness, greater longevity, greater sense of psychological health, flow as well to same-sex couples. And since Windsor and Obergefell, same-sex couples have been marrying at a very high rate. In 2013, 21% of same-sex couples were married, and that has now more than doubled to 45%. There were 100,000 same-sex marriages in the 4 months after Obergefell. All right, so that's all I'm going to say about the status aspect of marriage. What's important to recognize is it serves a clear, discernible public purpose. It's not principally an honorific. It's not just a way of awarding people, giving people a badge. It serves a function, and it seems to be the function is defensible, and we can see why the law, the function of the law of marriage plays this signaling, informational, and helps to support this norm-creating role, the social legibility, and so on. I'm going to be very brief with respect to the various legal incidents of marriage. They serve broad purposes. These are all the specific rights, the specific obligations that attach to marital status. 1,100 federal laws help to define these rights and obligations in federal law, and they're mainly defined in state law. You know, some of them help to represent the special emotion and support the special emotional closeness of married couples, like immigration rights and so on. What's important to recognize as well is that they're not just benefits, they're also special obligations. Homestead rights mean you can't just throw your spouse out of the joint homestead. You can't easily simply disinherit your spouse and so on. So couples take on special burdens and limitations, obligations, as well as receiving certain benefits. It's appropriate that we think these things through so that they're appropriate to the special commitment the married couples have made. I think those are being constantly revised. And as I say, I think it's important as a condition of just marriage that we also recognize the importance and the value of non-marital caring relationships that people are in. And continue to do what's already being done, which is to make available many of these specific privileges and benefits to non-married persons. Hospital visitation rights, powers of attorney, these things are already being shared in non-marital relationships. And we should go further so that marriage is fair to those who are outside of marriage. And I'm not going to say a lot about that. I think it's an important agenda. But I'll also say that the general contours of the benefits of marriage, the benefits and obligations, form a reasonably coherent and acceptable package. It's also interesting to look back. 20 years ago, David Chambers, a law professor, wrote an article called What If? And argued back then in 1996 and 1997 that the law of marriage, including these various benefits and obligations, was very well designed for same-sex couples. That very little needed to be changed other than the words husband and wife in order for that relationship to suit same-sex couples. The reason being that the law of marriage had been remade by the women's movement. There was formal spousal equality in marriage, which made marriage very well suited to same-sex couples. Prior to that revolution in marriage, and that's the big revolution in marriage, I think not same-sex marriage, but gender equality in marriage would not have been well suited to same-sex couples, and they wouldn't want any part of it. But marriage as it exists now is very well suited to same-sex couples. And in fact, what same-sex marriage does is help to entrench the norm of gender equality and spousal equality in marriage. So I think modern marriage, contemporary marriage, and same-sex marriage go together very well. And as I say, there is a project of rethinking these specific incidents, sharing them with people in non-marital relationships. But none of this, I think, calls for the kinds of radical reforms that some reformers are talking about. As I mentioned, Elizabeth Brake would call all of these relationships involving sharing some of the incidents of marriage, sharing a homestead, perhaps powers of attorney and so on, of a grandson and a grandmother, she would call that a marriage. But while it's true that we should perhaps recognize and support such a relationship with law, it would be a positive deterrent to call it a marriage. Nobody wants to be married to their grandmother, or no grandmother wants to be married to a grandson. So it's a slightly strange proposal to call them all marriages. But perhaps we should call them social pacts, as is done in France, and there might be other ways in which we can recognize them. Likewise, I don't think we need to eliminate the distinctive status of marriage, because it has a distinctive meaning. It's far better to support these to other non-marital caring relationships in their own name and in their own right while preserving marriage. That's all I want to say about that. And I guess just a word about marriage privatization, the contract. Again, I think we'd lose something by not having marriage as a distinctive status and relationship defined by law. I think that's part of what we lose with the Thaler-Sunstein proposals. There's also the contractualization proposal is interesting, but as any lawyer will immediately say, and as I've heard many times, there's some real value in having a package of default rules predefined by law for people entering into the marital relationship under the blinding influence of love. It's not easy to anticipate all the eventualities that married couples may need to face up to, and the status of law can help to define those things in advance for us. And then just finally about contractualizing marriage, contract tends to involve bargaining, and bargaining advantages a stronger partner. Marriage's status can help to protect the weaker partner, the less forward-looking partner perhaps, by building in elements of equity. And so there too, having a package of rules that anticipate the problems that may arise in marriage, and having judges concerned with equitable division of property and so on under the marital arrangement has some real benefits to it. So, okay, I'm going to leave it at that in terms of marital status, which I think serves a public function, is defensible, and marital incidents, which I think are eligible for disaggregation and redistribution to help to support other caring and caregiving relationships as we continue to think through those details. But those are questions of detail, not, it seems to me, questions of radical reform. Let me turn now to monogamy and the crucial question of how it can be understood and defended from the standpoint of liberal justice without resort to sexual moralism, I should say. It's not part of my argument that polygamous relations are inherently immoral or anything of that sort. And when I say monogamy, frankly, what I mean is marrying one spouse, two people pledging to build a life in common together. It seems to me the terms of that life in common are up to them. If they want to try, just for example, having a sexually open relationship, that's their business. It may be a bad idea, it may be a mistake, but as it were, and because Arthur said in another context, it's their mistake to make as long as they're doing it in common together. Now that's sometimes called consensual non-monogamy, but that's potentially misleading. I would call it consensual sexual non-exclusivity. I mean, if married couples want to swing, as they used to say back in the 70s, I guess, as long as they're not harming their children and so on, it seems to me it's basically their business. So it's plural marriage that I'm against, not sexual freedom. And the argument that I want to make is really very straightforward, and it's what polygamy amounts to based on everything we know about human experience as a social form, its effects on individuals and the larger society. The argument's not that it's necessarily or inherently immoral. It rather has to do with its structural inequality, its proneness to domination, conflict, and unfairness. So the argument is moral but not moralistic. All right. So, and I should also clarify, I'm not in favor of criminalization. In effect, polygamy has been decriminalized so long as people don't seek more than one actual marriage license. There's a very interesting case in Utah involving Cody Brown, the star of TV's Sister Wives, who brought a challenge to Utah's anti-bigamy statute, which might have been interpreted to prohibit having multiple religious marriages. The federal judge there struck down that interpretation of the anti-bigamy statute. So it seems to me what I'm against is equal recognition of plural marriages as marriages, I'm not in favor of criminalization. I would say this would be a form of discouragement. I also am open to the idea of protective recognition of some aspects of plural relationships if it would help protect the vulnerable, such as women or men who have been involved in such a relationship who might be disadvantaged at the dissolution of that relationship if it's given no legal effect at all. So there may be certain forms of protective recognition, not equal recognition, that are called for. I'll come back to that. All right, normative polygamy has been extremely common across human history. In 85% of the societies studied by anthropologists, it's the preferred form of marriage for the most wealthy and most powerful males. All emperors and emperor-like men, as was said in Imperial China, where it was estimated that as many as 10% of males may have practiced polygamy, or more precisely, polygyny, one husband with multiple wives. It's still extensively practiced in Africa and the Muslim world, parts of the Muslim world. And now, as before, it's associated with gender, economic, and social hierarchies among higher and low status males. So polygamy as polygyny can serve various social functions. In desperately poor regions of Africa and elsewhere, women may find it more advantageous to be the second or third wife of a relatively well-off farmer than the sole spouse of a destitute husband. Polyandry, marriages with multiple husbands, is quite rare, and typically, or almost always, is the result of dire poverty, such as a shortage of arable land. A small farm, a family farm, may simply be unable to support more than one family, and so two brothers may share a single wife, as in some poor Tibetan societies in southern China and Nepal. Now, in such situations, controlling male jealousy proves to be extremely difficult, according to those who've studied these things. And it's telling that whereas polygyny is often an exalted status to which the most successful males aspire, polyandrous marital arrangements seem to be the consequence of desperate circumstances. Now, what do we make of the fact that polygyny has been so common and polyandry so rare? Clearly, part of it's because of the dominance of patriarchy in human history, for sure, the prevalence of male domination. Evolutionary anthropologists and psychologists, many of them, also frequently argue that observed patterns reflect men's and women's differing evolved psychologies. And they argue, based on various kinds of evidence, contemporary as well as historical, that men tend to be far more attracted to plural sexual partners. I mention this only for what it's worth. It did figure in litigation in Canada, British Columbia, the reference case on polygamy in which in 2011, December 2011, the Supreme Court of British Columbia upheld the criminal statute, Canada's criminal prohibition on polygamy. Joseph Henrich, a leading evolutionary anthropologist who testified in that case along with a number of other expert witnesses, argued that legalizing all forms of polygamy will principally result in an increase in polygynous marriages by wealthy, prestigious men. And I quote, "Nothing of what we know about our species' evolved psychology or from the anthropological record indicates that either polyandry or forms of group marriage will spread beyond trivial frequencies." And so he concluded, the question of polygamy is a question of polygyny. But what does it amount to in practice, polygamy as polygyny? Considerable evidence suggests that polygamous families and societies are far more prone to various forms of conflict and inequality as compared with monogamous ones. These were ably summarized by Justice Robert Bauman of the Supreme Court of British Columbia in upholding, as I said, Canada's criminal prohibition in December 2011. He drew on an extensive record. There were no litigants in this case. It was a reference case. The Canadians could do this. The Attorney General in British Columbia posed a constitutional question because of its relevance in various prosecutions. And the judge in this case spent a year or more assembling expert witness testimony from leading experts who summarized various fields for him. Walter Scheidel, the chair of the Stanford Classics Department, discussed the origins of monogamy insofar as it's known. Rose McDermott, a comparativist at Brown University, drew on extensive empirical evidence cross-nationally in her own database. Joseph Henrich, the evolutionary anthropologist who I mentioned, testified about what's known from the field of evolutionary psychology and anthropology. And John Witte, a historian from Emory, summarized a work in ethics and religious history on the monogamous and plural marriage. And it's a very interesting, it's a 100,000 word opinion that's essentially a summary of all this expert witness testimony and the sort of social, scientific, historical, and ethical record. All right, so polygamy. Within families, polygamy tends to create intense jealousies and conflict among plural wives and children sharing a household. It lowers the average relatedness within families, and that's also associated with much greater violence in the home. Indeed, the Quran warns you cannot be equitable in a polygamous relationship no matter how hard you try. Polygamy tends to reduce the attention and resources that each child receives. It allows male heads of household to invest surplus resources in securing additional wives, leaving fewer resources for nurturing and educating rising generations. In comparison, monogamy increases the surplus resources available to be invested in children, contributing to happier, healthier children and greater social progress. One surprising finding from the experience of 19th century Mormon polygamy is that the children of lower status males actually had lower morbidity rates or better health outcomes than the children of higher status males, the reason being that the higher status males were able to wed more frequently and father more children, reducing the care and attention devoted to each child taken individually. In society, polygamy increases intersexual competition among men. It allows high-status males to acquire multiple wives and numerous offspring, but in so doing, it deprives lower-status males of anything like a fair chance to find a spouse. Unmarried lower-status males are thereby increased in the society, and unmarried lower-status males do what unmarried males do. They drink too much, take drugs, and fight. Seriously, they discount the future, the evidence shows, engage in risk-taking, status elevating behavior and so on, and rates of violence in society and so on are higher when there are significant numbers of unmarried, increased numbers of unmarried males. So women, children, and lower status males fare poorly under polygamy. And so Rose McDermott concludes, based on her survey of the evidence, and I quote, "Polygamy's negative effects are wide-ranging, statistically demonstrated, and independently verified using a variety of analytic tools." Walter Scheidel, and actually Adrian Lonnie, I think here in the history department in classics studies the origins of monogamy as well. The exact origins seem to be unknown, but they lie in ancient Greece before the historical period. it appears that normative monogamy, which limited all men, including the wealthiest and most powerful, to one wife at a time, contributed to more cooperative social relations and greater social success among the Greek city-states and the Roman Republic. Later, Western and other societies copied these more successful and more just social patterns. Monogamy spread with the influence of Rome and later Christianity, so its origins are Western but not Christian. The Western origins of monogamy suggest to some that it's a colonial and Christian imposition on non-Western cultures, but it was Mao who imposed monogamy in China. Kemal Ataturk, the father of modern Turkey, outlawed polygamy as part of his modernizing efforts in 1926. Japan did so earlier on its own, under the influence of missionaries, but it's on its own. And polygamy was banned in India's post-independence constitution for Hindus, though it was accommodated among the Muslim minority. And it does seem to me this is an important consideration. We live in an increasingly interconnected world and should consider the impact of our decisions on the burgeoning global culture of human rights, including women's rights and children's rights. Nowhere that women are equal is there any widespread social movement in favor of plural marriage. And where plural marriage exists but women are becoming empowered, polygamy is viewed as an important obstacle to women's equality. So the transition to institutionalized monogamy is associated with more egalitarian social relations generally, less inequality between men and women, reduced social conflict, less inequality among men, higher investments of children, and greater social progress. These are not simply a wide variety of important public goods. They include the basic human interests that are the currency of egalitarian justice. Children are owed a decent start in life. Women are owed a social order that helps to support egalitarian marital and family arrangements, and men are owed a fair opportunity to enter into family relations as a matter of basic justice. All of these are undermined by the practice of plural marriage as known to human experience. Now, there are obviously liberty interests involved if several consenting adults decide they want to settle down and pledge fidelity in a marriage-like arrangement. Excuse me. But liberal and constitutional theory and common sense allow that particular liberty interests can be overridden by the demands of equality. We need to define a scheme of equal basic liberties or rights that can be secured for all. And in its common forms, polygamy is not an opportunity that can be secured for all. Indeed, as an experienced social form, it's productive of a wide range of inequalities. So the case for same-sex marriage is radically discontinuous with everything we know about polygamy as a lived phenomenon. Same-sex marriage extends the basic value of equal liberty to a group long subject to prejudice and discrimination. It helps secure everyone's equal standing and fair opportunity to pursue a good and successful life. Plural marriage, in contrast, is strongly associated in practice with patriarchy and class and status hierarchies. Polygamy is hyper-traditional. Hence, it's oddly ironic that Chief Justice Roberts remarked in his Obergefell dissent, and I quote, "From the standpoint of history and tradition, a leap from opposite-sex marriage to same-sex marriage is much greater than one from two-person union to plural unions, which have deep roots in some cultures around the world." Well, that's true. Those traditions are patriarchal, and so it's a lesser leap from in a way, a traditional patriarchal marriage to a patriarchal plural marriage than to same-sex marriage. But if we take the Constitution's commitment to equal liberty as our baseline, then in fact marriage as it's developed as an equal relation among the spouses and same-sex marriage are in fact quite complementary. Now, just to add to this, there are several categories of principal considerations. I know I'm running out of time, so I'll be very brief here. But just to conclude with this, there are obviously principled considerations that help sharpen the distinction between same-sex marriage and plural marriage. First, preferences for polygamy are not equivalent to same-sex orientations. We know that a large class of people has deep-seated and stable same-sex orientations. No one has the orientation of only falling in love with two or more people at a time. People's felt desire for polygamous marriage appears to be highly variable and dependent on prevalent institutions and culture. Another set of considerations that count in favor of the two-ness of marriage has to do with practical aspects of stability and flourishing in the kind of relationship that a marriage is. Marriage nowadays is unique in the depth and breadth of its commitments. Two people come together to depend on upon each other very deeply and across wide segments of their lives, making each other uniquely vulnerable and deeply vulnerable to loss and betrayal, and needing to negotiate life in common together across many aspects of their lives. Bringing in a third person, making the dyad a triad, compounds the complexity of all these negotiations and seems a recipe for conflict. The classic social theory account is George Simmel's. Only in dyads do we get a perfect symmetry of reciprocal dependence. So with monogamy, each spouse depends reciprocally on the other. With plural marriage, you get Madison's Mischiefs of Faction writ small. The Mormons, interestingly, confined polygamy to the elect because they held that it required special virtue to manage it properly. And for that same reason, Mormon leaders, some of them at least, explicitly argue that it should not be practiced outside the Mormon community. A third consideration in favor of one spouse per person is distributive justice, distributive fairness. Marriage is a great good sought by the vast majority of people. We should secure the conditions within which this opportunity is available to all on fair terms, so that all people have a fair opportunity for a happy family life. And again, everything we know about plural marriage, even if it weren't predominantly polygamy, would suggest that the wealthy will be advantaged when it comes to securing additional spouses. Now, Andrew March of Yale, who has written on this as well, and we've interacted a bit on this, he jokingly likens this part of the argument for limiting everyone to one spouse to the Lockean proviso, limiting property acquisition in the state of nature. We must leave enough and as good in common for others. Very funny. Yet the evidence supports the notion that plural marriage tends to take the form of polygamy, disadvantaging low-status males in the marriage market. And in any case, I think it would tend to advantage the wealthy. Again, based on everything we know, monogamy helps furnish the social bases for a fair distribution of the opportunities for family life. Finally, it has been argued for decades that same-sex marriage would degrade marriage for heterosexuals, but it's never been explained how. Plural marriage, on the other hand, would change the character of marriage for everyone. It would undermine the assurances that the law of monogamous marriage has underwritten, the assurance that's a crucial part of the good of marriage, that two people have settled down together with each other. All right, finally, I do have one final point. What about polyamory or egalitarian group marriages, which are much discussed? I mean, because critics of my position will say, look, you've only talked about, you know, plural marriage of the past. What about plural marriage of the future? This egalitarian form, polyfidelity, polyamory, horizontal, non-dominating networks, network relations involving multiple partners of various genders in which all the participating spouses have equal and reciprocal rights. My colleague Robert George loves to talk about polyamory, and he's sure that it's coming, or so he says. At the other end of the political spectrum, lots of highly progressive people seem to agree. Some of them are in this room. I have no crystal ball, but I'm skeptical. What's striking at the moment is the utter lack of systematic evidence. There's not a single systematic study of egalitarian plural marital relationships. These seem never to have existed as a stable social form, ever, anywhere. The British Columbia court reckoned that there may be 120 polyamorous households in Canada. Elizabeth Emmons' oft-cited article, Monogamy's Law, in the Columbia Law Review, is based on four or five thruples and moresomes who appeared in various places, like the Jerry Springer Show, or in court records. Her evidence is frankly anecdotal, and this is just an exploratory piece. Conservatives endlessly repeat an estimate of 500,000 polyamorous in the United States. This was a guess put forward by a polyamory advocate in a 2009 Newsweek article, and it has since been removed from the online version of the article because it's groundless. But some conservatives continue to refer to it as an oft-cited statistic, which is shameful. Elizabeth Brake, who advocates minimal marriages, I've tried to open with respect to numbers and gender, straining for evidence, suggests that Ethan Waters' Yuppie Ethnography, Urban Tribes, the subtitle of which Our Friends, the New Family, she speculates that this heralds a new form of family life, which she dubs urban tribalism. Waters chronicled a household of well-off 20 and 30-somethings back in the 1990s, postgraduates living in San Francisco together in a household, sort of reminiscent of TV's Friends. Various people slept with various other people and they became like family. Yet in reality, it was a stage of life. Waters' website now describes them as married with children. Another great TV show. One of the most often cited authorities on polyamory is the late Deborah Taj Annapol, and she's cited very frequently. Her website, she just passed away recently, her website is called Love Without Limits. Her online biography at the International School of Temple Arts describes her as an explorer of the spaces where sex, spirit, and sustainability, love, and ecology meet. Her tantric journey through inner and outer space is an ongoing process of discovery. She's a kind of spiritual sex therapist operating out of California. She advocates pelvic heart integration. So what do we make of polyamory? Conservatives urge us to see it, and there's more than this, I don't want to, but this is actually the work that's being cited in academic articles, including Annapol. So what should we make of polyamory? Conservatives urge us to see it as a stage on the slide from same-sex marriage to sexual anarchy. Progressives herald it as a new egalitarian vision of non-monogamous adult networks. But all we have is an insubstantial miscellany of anecdotes, speculation, and free love advocacy and fantasy. These are no basis for concluding anything. And many of these examples are fluid adult networks that don't involve anything like marital commitment, and it's not at all clear that in many cases people want anything like marital commitment. I don't think it's true, frankly, of the of Annapol and the folks that she's talking to. What may be most revealing here is the absence of evidence. It's certainly possible that polyamorous today are like gays 40 years ago, even in places like San Francisco and Amsterdam, you know, fearing persecution and about to emerge from the closet. It's entirely possible, and I'm sure we'll see more of it. But at least it seems to me this, that marriage is a complex institution, and here the law should follow social practice, not lead social practice. Nobody's calling for criminalization or anything like that. People are completely free to lead their lives and to engage in experiments in living. But given what we know now, I conclude that normative monogamy best secures citizens' equal basic liberties, their equal status and standing, and their fair opportunity to pursue the good of family life. We have no basis for concluding anything about egalitarian plural marriage. So to conclude, for now we can say that recognizing marriage as a relationship of two and only two persons, opposite sex or same sex, helps to secure for all, quoting John Rawls, a fully adequate scheme of equal basic liberties and the fair opportunity to pursue the great good of family life. And just finally, I would say, in the paper that I circulated, there's a final section called Fiddling While Rome Burns. I think the real crisis of family life, you know, in this country is the class divide with respect to marriage that Putnam has very ably described and others have described to Kahn and Carbone in their book. That difference where marriage is pretty well flourishing among the college educated who are waiting to have children to marry. The marriages are very stable. The divorce rates are back where they were in the 1960s. On the other hand, high school dropouts or people with only a high school degree are overwhelmingly choosing to cohabit, have children. It's often on the expectation that they will eventually get married, but the cohabiting relationships are much less stable. Often they're not getting married because they don't have the economic wherewithal to support a household. They sometimes have more traditional attitudes towards marriage, think that the husband should be the breadwinner, but the husband's not able to be the breadwinner given the economic insecurity of people with lower levels of education in our society. That's a real tragedy. It's an aspect of the tragedy of distributive inequality in our society, and that's what we should be focusing on, it seems to be, as I'm sure we will, as support for same-sex marriage continues to grow. I apologize for going over in terms of my time, but I'm finished.
Well, my understanding of liberal values was that they required equal citizenship, equal in the public sphere. But with respect to the private sphere, they did not necessarily owe people. I mean, this is the debate between Oaken maybe and Rawls, right? So you seem to be assuming that, the state has to weigh in against marriages where there is inequality even if there is public equality, citizenship's rights are not interfered with, the exit rights, et cetera. Right. So that was the question about liberal theory. With respect to different types of marriages, I haven't thought about this before, but in terms of equality, you know, the empirical matters, bisexuals need people of both sexes, presumably. I'm not a psychologist.
No, it means you can fall in love with either one, not that you fall in love with both
well,
at the same time.
My understanding of bisexuality was that it was a richer life if you had both, not just either okay. one. So empirically, a union of four, let's say, of you know, two couples, right. would be best for them.
Right.
The description of polyandry, well, I call it polyandry. This is where women have, you know.
Multiple husbands.
Right. The thing is that when you describe polygyny with
right.
men having more, when I think about women now who are also earners, wage earners, right? The problems about multiple wives having to be supported by the man and not enough money for the children, that empirically seems to be diminished by the fact that the man could be staying at home and taking care of the children, and he's got, there are five wives who were lawyers, you know, corporate lawyers. I mean, this is a fantasy, but the point is to rely on a view about the economic division of, you know, gender labor, that's not necessary in order to imagine equitable relations.
Right.
The other thing is that empirically, when women are weak, entering into a relationship with a dominant class, the enemy, sleeping with the enemy, right? One would feel much more comfortable going into it, one man, five women, than one under, class woman with one dominant man. So I'm not sure that I buy the view that, you know, polygyny is the way, it has to be the way you've described it.
Right, right. Well,
just empirical question.
But the first one is normative.
Yeah, so the empirical, I'm not gonna say more about it because I mean, there's undoubtedly more work to be done, but I'm following what seems to be we glean from the historical record. And, as I said, polyandry is extremely rare. As I understand it, even now, where in China and elsewhere, as inequality rises, polygyny is making a return. There are tens of thousands, apparently, of rich Chinese men. I've not read as much about women. I'm sure there are some, but as I understand it, it predominates. With second households in the United States, often they want the second households to be established here so the children are born here. It's being discussed, so it's making a comeback. I'm just tracking practice here and the evidence. So we can imagine these other things, as you say. But as I say, even if we do imagine them, it seems to me there's a substantial basis for preserving monogamy as the marital form, not criminalizing the other things, but preserving monogamy as the recognized marital form until we learn more about these other things as arrangements that serve the good of individuals and society. With respect to the Oaken-Rawls debate, I mean, I understood that debate as sort of Oaken started the debate and then Rawls sort of said, no, that's what I meant all along.
Well, she said that. I mean, then concluded that.
Yeah, well, look, I mean, it's people, look, I think women should be absolutely free to enter into traditional marriages, for example, if they want to. That's their own. But the job of the law and of our public institutions is to ensure that they have a fully fair opportunity to make that free decision. That as they grow up as young women and so on, that they have the education and the social support, and we overcome needed to make an absolutely free decision. So and actually, liberal freedoms cannot be secured unless private institutions, including churches and families, participants in those institutions respect people's basic equal rights. I mean, that would mean raising their daughters and so on with an eye towards their equality of opportunity. Predominantly, making sure that they receive at least an adequate big start in life for the sake of their equal freedom. So I do think that the values of the liberal democratics only flourish if they penetrate and shape the private sphere as well as the public sphere. That's consistent with Lockean liberalism and I think Rawlsian liberalism.
Steve, I thought that was a terrific lecture, so thank you for it. I'm going to ask you a question that maybe only a constitutional law professor could find of any interest or significance, so I'll be the one to ask it. When and if the case comes to the Supreme Court, the aggrieved, the person who's been convicted of the crime of polygamy and is appealing the case and is asking relief or relief from the Supreme Court, as our discourse of constitutional law is currently framed, there would be two ways in which the court could return a negative response to that litigant. The court could say, well, you actually have put on the table a claim of infringement on a basic or fundamental liberty, but the state has persuaded us that it has sufficient justification for limiting your fundamental liberty. That would be a compelling governmental interest in the lingo that prevailed. Or the court could say, you haven't shown us an infringement on a fundamental liberty.
Right.
As you began your defense of monogamy, I had thought that where you would be heading would be to my first alternative. There's an infringement on a fundamental liberty, there's sufficient justification. But as you went on, it began to strike me that you might be taking a position, if I put this in Rawlsian terms, right, that the fundamental right involved is a right of equal access to a scheme of equal basic liberties, right? And the scheme is complex because it involves certain kinds of equality as well as certain kinds of liberty. And as I heard you flesh out the argument, it struck me that you might very well say, given the way things work, polygamy just doesn't fit as a component into a scheme of equal basic liberties, so the case would fail at the first step,
right,
not at the second. I think that's my question.
So the only thing is, I wanted to take...
Which way would you do it?
And you know,
does it matter to the deeper issues that are involved which choice you would make?
So I went very fast over that, and what I wanted to take the issue of criminal law basically off the table. What polygamists have been doing for some time now, for decades, is only getting one civil marriage license and then having religious marriages. And so they will say, as they said in the Green case and in the Cody Brown case, in the eyes of the state, I believe I'm only in one marriage. In the eyes of my church, I believe I'm in multiple marriages, but that's no business of yours. And, you know, fair enough. I wouldn't prosecute people for entering into multiple religious marriages. It was that interpretation of the Utah statute, which is ambiguous, which was struck down in the Cody Brown case. You know, that there was no prosecution there, but a prosecutor said about the Cody Browns, the sister wives people, they're violating the law on TV every week. And so they sought a injunction, I guess, against the enforcement of that law. So I would say non-recognition in law of plural marriages. In law, we recognize one marriage, but if people want to cohabit and call them marriages without getting marriage licenses, so I would call it a regime of toleration and even, but not persecution. But am I answering your question?
My case could still come to court.
Yeah.
The person wants recognition.
People wants recognition. Okay, then fine.
Have to practice mono theory.
Okay, no, that's fine. But then I would say our social interests are such. So I construe the basic right as a right to enter into one marriage, because that's something we can secure for everybody. You could say it's compossible. We just don't have any evidence based on the human record that we could secure for everyone an equal right to enter into plural marriages. We don't have that, and we have a reasonable basis for an apprehension of considerable social harm. Now, I think the case, I didn't talk at all about the adult incest case. The case is even stronger there because the prospective harms, while they're not direct and assignable, like in Mill's case of the harm principle, there he's talking about infringements on liberty, they're downstream, but they apply to children within families. So in both cases, admittedly, we're talking about downstream harms not necessarily a harm that's being done by an egalitarian polygamous family, relatively egalitarian. The Cody Browns are still patriarchal in the traditional form. It's one husband with four wives now, and he did bring in his fourth wife without consulting the first three. But it's still, I wouldn't call it oppressive. It's just not particularly equal. But recognizing that form of marriage wouldn't just allow the good variants, but would allow the variant in general. So I think we're entitled to not recognize that general form. And that would be the form.
Charles Reed.
I fear I detect a circularity in your argument. The circle, let me see if I can describe the circle. There are all these possible arrangements and you're wonderfully open to allowing them to go forward. However, marriage describes a particular kind of arrangement which has particular social benefits, and society is well justified in awarding those benefits and that putting that label and reserving that label and its incidence for that situation so described. Mm-hmm. Now, the attempt to extend that beyond two people is getting into trouble without any evidence that it produces social goods, and lots of evidence that it produces all kinds of social harms and inequalities, and as you set it out, fine. But of course, that's true at a time when, although many societies have recognized polygamy, I don't believe many or any societies have recognized same-sex marriages. So, of course, we have no evidence about plural same-sex marriages because they haven't been legal. So that's the circularity of your argument.
Yeah. I don't think that's the case. People settled down in same-sex households and partnerships for decades before it was legally recognized. So we had ample evidence of, it took a while to get sort of systematic evidence, and it still may not be systematic enough, but we do have considerable evidence. We've had decades of evidence about people. Admittedly, you could say it's not that long or whatever, but it's considerable and it's sufficient. And it's sufficient, after all, in the same terms that it's been sufficient with respect to heterosexuals, because we've extended the right to marry one other person quite broadly, and quite properly, I think, because it's a basic good and a basic opportunity. But we do have that evidence, and we don't have any parallel evidence that we've gotten in the last 30 years with respect to same-sex couples, with respect to these plural marriages. I just don't think we do.
Plural same-sex marriages.
Oh, plural same-sex marriages. Yeah. I've had people ask me about this, and they've mentioned examples of people. I think we'd have to address these cases as the litigants come up. In the examples that have been given to me, it's not clear that there are arrangements where people are living together in relations of threesomes. I was told at Fordham University last week about two older men with a younger man. Now, do they really want to enter into a reciprocal, three-way marriage? It wasn't clear to me that they did. I think we'll have to, But if we don't have the experience of them, then of course it would be premature to start. It's possible you're correct. But in that case too, then we'd have to recognize, I think, that marriage is going to be an equal arrangement available to people generally, and there are going to be instances of people not, by of course, exemplifying the problems that we worry about from the general type. But if it's not a basic opportunity to enter into a plural relationship, and that general type has these negative characteristics, then I think we're entitled to withhold the recognition of the plural relationship. It doesn't seem to mean invidious in the same sort of way, so long as everyone's entitled to marry one person. It seems to me then we're getting into a preference, which is something like an expensive taste to marry a third person. But it's not an invidious mark of discrimination because it's something that anyone might want to enter into. And the exclusion is not based on prejudice against a class of people, and it's not denying anyone the basic thing that everyone needs as we understand people to lead a happy life. At least this is how it seems to me.
We have time for one more brief question, and Richard Tuck is the last person.
Thank you. Thanks. Hi, Steve. I wasn't clear that your account of the evils of polygamy had anything to do with the legal character of polygamy. The evils seem to be, so to speak, features of the sociology of polygamy.
Yeah.
So I wanted to put this question to you, supposing, which I guess is not impossible, particularly you know, as societies may become more influenced by Islam and so on, that it became very widespread practice that there were polygamous marriages, and the children are brought up in them and so on, polygamous relationships, I mean.
Yeah.
And that they were, and children are brought up in them, all the things that you think are unjust, possibly, that lead to various sort of social ills. Would you still think that that should be legally tolerated? In other words, how far does your argument against giving polygamy legal status as marriage go if it became a sufficiently widespread practice that it appeared to undermine our legal, our liberal values? It seems to me the logic of this is that you should then not take the position of toleration that you said you took.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Well, we'd have to think about what effect intolerant laws would have at that point. It seems to me it is an argument for maintaining monogamy now, that we hope that it has a kind of educative effect of encouraging people to think about the opportunity to marry in these egalitarian terms, and that it, as I said, it does seem as though the preference for polygamous relations, though it does go along with, it's not a requirement within Islam, it's available within Islam, and in fact, Islam historically limited the number of wives that were permissible against a background when polygamy was permissible and unlimited.
But it looks as if you're sort of the position you want to take,
yeah,
which is I'm perfectly happy to be a liberal as long as they don't
right,
want to have the label of marriage.
Yeah, no, fair.
I don't quite see why that's consistent. Because, in the ways you're interested.
So it's very good. I mean, look. Well, fair enough. So in the earlier versions, I did play around with the idea of keeping the criminal prohibition on the books, not to actively persecute people because they're so few, and they're not actually many of these. They're not actually harming people. In the Cody Brown case, it's clear that the wives are, they were not, he married each one of them when they were roughly the same age. He didn't marry any of them as teenagers, as happens in many of the fundamentalist communities. And in fact, he married the first three wives, and then they all started having children together, so they would all be raising them together. So in a way, it's the optimal case for this sort of thing, almost getting close to polyamory. In other cases, in fact, in other cases in Canada, of the Patriarch of Bountiful, which is the community up there, the patriarch who has 34 wives and 120 children, and he's appeared on television and so on. He's quite garrulous and in some ways seems to be pretty good. But he was marrying underage women religiously, but his defense was that he never touched them until they were legal. But he was cultivating them through the religion. Now that's problematic. There you'd want to find something. You would not want to be quite so liberal, it seems to me, when it comes to that kind of thing, and you'd have to think about how to get at that. But I did toy with the idea, simply for the expressive purposes, to keep the criminal statutes on the books. What happened in Utah was that it gives prosecutors too much discretion. These prosecutors in Utah went on the air and said, you know, they kind of, one of them threatened the Browns with prosecution. And I don't think that was appropriate. If they're not harming anyone, and as long as it's a very small number, the social harm is not there, and they're not engaging in the harm. Now, if one were to project this as a group, and one would have to think about the harm, then one would have to think about some other cases. It's not an easy question to answer. One would have to think about ways in which these arrangements. I mean, they're not all. There are many polygamous families that are. Let's put it this way. The other thing to be said on the positive side about this, and this was something that was said by Cody Brown in litigation, is There are many men that sleep with many women, father children, and take no responsibility for them. He takes responsibility for all these children, and it appears that he's a decent father to them. So I think there are costs associated with the non-recognition of polygamy. I mean, his children don't have the benefits of having their marriages recognized in law. So there are costs there. I don't want to deny that. And there is a religious tradition behind it and so on. So I think it's a difficult issue. And one wouldn't want, I mean, the criminal law is a very big gun to use, and I think it really has to be restricted to cases where people are harming others or engaging in something that threatens a very severe harm. Like, I would keep the rules on the book with respect to incest. They're because of the ways in which that prospective possibility would seem to me to introduce a vulnerability into the family that would be prospectively very harmful to children. But when it comes to polygamy, I mean, it's a difficult issue. But I do not think that would be I do not think, at least under our current. But I welcome the fact that there are very few polygamous families in the country. I think that's a good thing. I think it's important. I think it would also be important to maintain the sort of the social normative judgment that we have about polygamy, at least in its traditional form, that it does have this inegalitarian character and is not to be welcomed.
Steve, this has been provocative in a plural ways, plurally interesting, but I think we can agree as one that this is good.
Enough is enough. Thank you very much. No, I'm sorry.